Hey guys, Pastor Darren here at Seattle Revival Center. Tell you a quick story. At the beginning of 2016, the Lord spoke to me and said, "You're doing local church well, but I've called you to be a revival center." So we retreated along with our leadership team to have a weekend to just pray into, discuss, and strategize what is revival and what does a revival center look like. But little did we know, that same weekend, Jeremy and Miranda Nelson were hosting a conference called Decree Conference. It was supposed to go 3 days, but it didn't end. We quickly learned about what God was doing in San Diego. We sent our leadership team to go. There was one particular night when Jeremy Nelson had our team stand. He said, "Washington, please stand." Jeremy saw in the spirit a massive apple, and he began to declare that the apple wine is going to begin flowing in Washington State. It's the wine of his peace. It's the wine of his intimacy. And indeed, it's a very intoxicating wine. Man, our team went flying. They were blasted. They came home. They began laying hands on people back here in Seattle, and revival broke out. That was 1 week before our very own conference. Are you ready for this? Called Declaration Conference. It likewise was supposed to be a three-day event, but it didn't. And what we are going after is not a purpose within His presence. What we are stating is that His presence is the purpose. We are indeed attempting to create atmospheres where God shows up, and guess what? Night after night, He keeps showing up and He keeps showing off. People are getting healed, people are getting saved, people are getting delivered from drugs and demons and all kinds of stuff. Indeed, this is one of the most exciting times to be alive. The Holy Spirit is moving on the face of the earth, and like Joshua Mills said right at the very beginning, if you want to be a part of what God is doing, all you have to say is yes. It's such an honor to have you on tonight's broadcast. We hope you enjoy what God is doing here in Seattle. We would invite you to engage by sending up your prayer request by clicking the link. Also, you can chat. There's this amazing community of people on here at srclive.com. Let us know how we can be praying for you. Celebrate each other when God answers prayer. The only thing that we would ask is that you wouldn't use the chat as a platform to promote your ministry or to sell a product. It's really just a community where we can celebrate each other in the Lord. We would also ask that when the time comes that you would engage by giving into what God is doing here in Seattle. So when it comes time to give, pray and ask the Lord what He would have you give, and sow intentionally into this move, knowing that you are going to reap something special and significant because you're sowing into good soil. So we would ask that you would pray and consider giving tonight into what the Lord is doing here in Seattle, the Apple Wine Awakening. Know this, we are cheering you on. Please let us know how we can be praying for you and how we can partner with however the Lord is moving in your home, in your church, in your city, in your state. And remember, you are absolutely loved. It's about to get crazy. I'm so glad you're here. Let's stay in touch. Let's get to the service. Awesome, me too. How many of you here were here last night? Oh, a lot of you. Oh, all of you. Amazing. We're in for a real treat this morning. But one of the things that we actually, well,
Let's just do this. Let's open up in prayer. Jesus, thank you so much for this day that you have made, that you have created. And we just choose to be glad and just to delight in it and to delight in your glory. And just, yeah. We just delight in you. Father, we just delight in your approval. We just delight in your love and your affections for us. We just thank you so much for your mercies that are new like the dew on grass in the morning. We thank you that we are forgiven, that we are loved, that we are righteous, and we just love you. We thank you for everything that you have in your heart for us this morning. Yeah. We just thank you for everything that you have in store for us this morning, and we just declare that we love you. Yeah, and we just want whatever's in your heart for us. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So what we thought we'd do is just begin with just a few little testimonies and encounters that you guys had last night. We'll just do a few. So encounter stuff that you experienced, and we just say right off the bat that this is a safe place. So you're not weird, and you're not crazy. And so don't think that you're weird or crazy. We just want you to know this is a safe place just to be real and honest and transparent. And so I just say that right off the bat, that this is a safe place to share. And so, who would like to go first? And what we'll want to do is probably just like keep it, like some of you guys might have had like crazy encounters, you know, but we'll just want to keep it to about 2 minutes per testimony. And that'll create an atmosphere here. All right, who's first? Just wave at me real high. Look at all the hands. All right. All right, awesome. Come on up. Let's welcome her. Yeah. Come on. And what's your name?
Lana.
Awesome. I guess we just need one. Lana, what did Jesus do last night?
Hey, I wasn't even here.
You weren't. Awesome.
I wasn't able to be here. And then this morning, I was listening to the podcast. Thank you very much. And I was pottering around getting ready. And some things were had on my heart this morning. And all of a sudden, boom, 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 boom. The Lord spoke. He said this. He said, this is why I want you to do it this way. This is what you're going to get out of this. Yes, go for it and do this. Start a home group. And I'm just in shivers right now just from listening to the podcast.
Wow. That's amazing.
Thank you.
Thanks for sharing, Alana. That's so good. So the Lord gave you some blueprints. Isn't that cool? Awesome. All right. Who else? Okay, awesome. Come on up. Yeah. Of course, Sandra. You gotta come up and come to the light. Come as you are. You can be a friend of Darren's. All right, come here. You weren't here either. Look at all these people that weren't even here last night, and they got more courage than all y'all. I'm just kidding. Oh my goodness.
This morning, the Lord woke me up, and
you also watched it this morning.
Yeah, and I got some blueprints too.
All right. So what happened? Oh, what happened?
Well, the prophecy that I had, I don't think it was a week ago, talked about different pathways and treasures. And I can see, just listening to him talk, all the different pathways and treasures that the Lord has put in my life. I can't go into it, but anyway, I got a title for a book.
A title for a book? Come on. What is it? Yeah, you have to share.
My Heart Beyond the Veil.
Take My Heart Beyond the Veil. That's a beautiful title for a book.
And the Lord said, get going on your salsa business now.
On your salsa business.
Get it in.
Because her husband, Edward, makes really good. He's a real Mexican, and he makes incredible salsa. And what else?
Well, there's lots of things, but that's okay.
Okay, guys, stretch out your hands. Father, we thank you for Sandra. Father, we just thank you for all the heavenly strategies for this business. Thank you for supernatural creativity. We bless this book. What's it called again? The Heart?
Take My Heart Beyond the Veil.
We just bless this project. Take My Heart Beyond the Veil. Father, we just ask for encounters, Father, that this would be a book of encounters and an invitation to step into encounters beyond the veil. Whoa. Amen. Bless you, Sandra. All right, yeah, who else? Okay, yeah, are you guys together? Yeah, come on up, you guys. Bring your family. Come on, let's welcome this beautiful family. You guys are, thank you guys for sharing, and just, this is so cool. Awesome. Hi, what's your name?
My name is Wendy.
Awesome, what happened?
Well, my work is moving my whole plant out to South Carolina and in the next year, and we've been praying about whether or not we're supposed to go or just stay and find a job where we're at. And when Stevie was talking about the gates that were in northern Scotland, I saw a gate in South Carolina in Charleston where we're supposed to go, and that we're going through the Nest class that Stevie does a lot of the hosting for right now, and we're seeing that the reason we're going through the Nest now is to train, because we are going to South Carolina and there's a gate there that we are to operate in that gate in Charleston.
And you saw that last night?
Yeah, saw that last night.
Very cool, very cool. Thanks, Wendy, amazing. Hi, what's your name?
My name is John, and it was really awesome last night. There's a couple things that happened, but it was about the gate thing too. Stevie was preaching, and he was talking about, and he's done this on the Nest too, and it's grabbed me every time, but like every time it's like brand new. And last night he was saying, in order to get your blueprints, you have to die. You have to let down your desires. And for South Carolina, we don't want to go. I lived 20 years in Fort Smith, and I made a verbal ungodly covenant when we first moved here, and I said, I will never go back to the South as I hear an audible voice of God, because I don't like the humidity and the snakes and yada yada. And so South Carolina is worse than Fort Smith, and I'm like, Lord, you have could not have picked a worse place. And so I've had this fleshly struggle and laying down my desires. And so last night was just a solidification again to lay down what we want so we can get the blueprints. Because if we don't get the blueprints, what's the purpose of all this? You know? And it was during the same season, Wendy got her word. We talked about this morning during breakfast, and now I'm kind of going blank, nervousness probably. But I got to say the same thing. This is why we're going to South Carolina. It is the gate. We're to become gatekeepers, and that's what the Lord told us 3 or 4 months ago. You have 1 year to prepare. You have 1 year, and it was a real strong. I'm like, okay, we're starting the Nest. So, I mean, you can't really go through it in a year. It's like a 3-year program. We're trying to get rid of all of our junk and get our DNA cleansed. And, you know, there's a lot of things you have to go through. And I'm like, Lord, we're not even close to being ready. But with all of our heart, we're pressing in, doing everything that we know to do, and asking God to, by His mercy and His grace, just take us from where we are to where He is. And He's accelerating things. But it's really neat to get the same word that Wendy got last night at the exact same time that we are going. And to get our blueprints, we have to die to get our blueprints, and then we have to be willing to go. And we are going to be gatekeepers. And what that looks like, we're not real sure. But I know in the spirit, it has to be in the spirit first if we can manifest to be able to lead anything or a group. I'll stop talking. So
it's really good. So now there's anticipation. You want to pray?
Yeah, of course. Yes.
Wisdom. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Ooh, great wisdom. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Father, we thank you for their willingness to stand and be watchmen on the wall. We thank you, Lord, that they are the gate's head, that they are the head, not the tail. Father, we just increase that anointing. We increase your presence. We thank you for greater clarity and revelation and understanding as they walk hand in hand with the living beings of the seven spirits of God. So let that revelation come. Revelators, oracles, oracle meaning speaking the revelations from heaven, oracles. We just call forth that blueprint. We call forth that destiny. We thank you right now for the angel of Gateshead that sits on the border of England to Scotland. We just release you to come and help this couple in Jesus' name.
Lord, thank you for this beautiful couple, John and Wendy. And Father, in the name of the Lord, we send them out. We send them, Lord God, and we ask heaven's resources. We ask for heaven's help. We ask that all of heaven is behind them. God, I ask that every angel that they need will be sent. Lord, with the permission of the captain of the host, I ask that you send every angel that they need to go before them, to help them, to surround them, to bring resources, to bring help, and even to get rid of the snakes. And Lord, put a mantle of government upon this couple, that they may guard the gates and that they may open the gates so that the King of glory might come in. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, that the King of glory will come in.
Thank you, Jesus, that you've not given him a spirit of fear of the future, but you've given him a spirit of a sound mind, of strength, of joy, because the joy of the Lord will be your strength in this season. And we just increase that levels of joy, of unspeakable, exuberant joy. Ah, wow, wow, wow. Christ before you, Christ behind you, Christ to your right, Christ to your left, Christ above you, Christ beneath you. Strength come, encouragement come, clarity.
We just declare the oil of the Lord, that he would grease you right up, that you would slide right into place. Grace for a transition. Yeah, it's slippery, slippery, slippery. Yeah, it'd be like on a slip and slide, sliding right into South Carolina. Whoa, yeah, yeah, yeah. Mess them up so you can set them up. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And Father, we just thank you that there's going to be no anxiety. No anxiety. No anxiety. No anxiety. Whoa, yeah, yeah, yeah. Put your head in the box.
Lord, thank you that this couple is a beautiful offering to you.
Whoa. All right, well, yeah, one more. Awesome. Come here, buddy. Hi, Larry. Thanks for sharing, buddy. What's up?
So the whole thing was awesome from start to finish. But what happened to me was during the, I call it impartation time, I was over here and kind of continuing the worship. And I had an encounter where I was taken up to heaven. I took a big drink out of the river of life. I picked a fruit off the tree of life. It gave me strength. And Jesus took me by the hand and led me up to the throne of God. And, you know, the Bible says we can boldly approach. Yeah.
Hey, would you guys welcome this morning Stephen Mckie? Come on. Hey, buddy, do you want to preach down there or preach up here? Yeah. All right, stay standing. Why don't you stretch your hands? Stephen loves it when I pray for him. So if you just stretch out your hands. Whoa, Jesus! Bless Stevie! Lord.
Yeah.
That was a good prayer. Wow. That went well. Last night, what's your name again? Darren. Darren put ladders up there for me to climb, and it seemed quite funny, but I remember I actually spoke about the secret of the stairs. That was prophetic, what Darren did, even though he didn't realize he was being prophetic. Darren thought he was just being funny, but he was actually being prophetic. Pathetic. Oh. So I'm going to speak about something I actually spoke about at the school, but I really feel I have to speak about it again, and it's about Mount Zion. Mount Zion, and then Jane is going to speak on the courts, I think. And then Jane feels we've got a court case to do. So I'm really setting the scene in terms of talking about the governmental realms in heaven, about the government. Mount Zion is actually the governmental arena in heaven. And then Jane's going to speak about the courtroom and how the courtroom functions. And then we're going to actually do a courtroom session. Is that right, Jane? Unless God changes it. Jane is whacked. So Lord, thank you for your presence today. Thank you that we can come beyond the veil. That was so beautiful. Where was that person? Thank you so much for that. That was so beautiful that we can come beyond the veil. Lord, thank you that we as a group today, this is not just another wee session. Lord, thank you that you can bring us in by faith, that we can step in through the veil into the governmental arena of heaven, and that we can stand there, Lord God, that because of your blood, because of the cross, because of grace, we actually have come already to this place called Mount Zion, the governmental arena of heaven. And Lord, that you're calling your ecclesia up higher. You're calling your church to operate and function in the governmental realms of heaven. Lord, for the first time, maybe ever, we are being called back to where we should always have been, and that is functioning from heaven to earth, that we will fulfill the Lord's prayer, that thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven, that we will be like Jesus, that he came from heaven to earth, but he also lived in heaven and earth at the same time. So Lord, thank you that you're calling a people to live in heaven and earth at the same time, that we have been seated in heavenly places far above all principalities and powers. And Lord God, there's thrones set in heaven, and the throne of Jesus is there, but also there is thrones for us because we are kings and priests. He is the King of Kings, but we are kings in this governmental realm. And Lord, you have raised us up to be kings and priests in the order of Melchizedek, far greater than any movement that we've ever seen before. Kings and priests functioning with the full stature of Christ from the heavenly realms, changing all creation, because all creation is groaning, all creation has waited for this day. Lord, I thank you that as we come into this governmental place right now, that we stand here, the angels are surrounding us. Lord God, even the atmosphere now is shifting. The cloud of witnesses are here. Jesus is here. God the judge is here. Because it's not God visiting earth, it's us visiting Mount Zion. Thank you, Jesus. Hebrews 12, 22 to 26. By the way, Matt became a Christian last night. Well done, Matt. He's going to get baptized today. We're going to get the baptismal pool, Matt, for you. So Hebrews 12, 22 to 26 says, But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church, ecclesia, of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, to Jesus the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better than that of Abel. But you have come to Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem. Some people preach and say you can't go to heaven, you can't, it's a sovereign thing, you can't just go. You have already come. It was past tense, it says you have come to Mount Zion. What is Mount Zion? Mount Zion is the governmental arena in heaven. And today I'm going to speak about what's in Mount Zion and some of the functions in Mount Zion and how to function there. So what's in Mount Zion? The city of the living God. Heavenly Jerusalem. Countless angels. The assembly of those registered in heaven, the ecclesia. Do you know the ecclesia, the church, is actually in heaven? We are the ecclesia. Jesus said, I will build my ecclesia, but the ecclesia is not on earth. The ecclesia is in heaven. We've been functioning on the earth for far too long because we're born to function as the ecclesia from heaven. God the judge is there. The spirit of the righteous who have been made perfect are there. That's the cloud of witnesses, Jesus and the blood. So Mount Zion. I'm going to go through different scriptures about Mount Zion and what is there, all right? So Psalm 2 verse 6. It's the place where the king dwells. Psalm 2 verse 6 says that, but as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy mountain. The king is in Mount Zion. Jesus is the king. He's not just Jesus, our brother there. He's Jesus the king. It's to do with government. His throne is there. The king's throne is there. His throne under his throne is built upon righteousness and justice. The king is there. Right, come on. Preach it, Stevie. It's where the judge and the justice system dwells. Psalm 48:11 says, let Mount Zion be glad, let the people of Judah be full of joy, because you are right in how you judge. You see, we need to see things change on the earth, but we need to realize that the justice system is in the heavenlies in Mount Zion, and we have already come to Mount Zion. So we need to go to that place in the heavenlies, that place where we have actually already come, but we've not realized it, because the judge is there, and the justice system of heaven is there. The king is there, the justice system is there. It's a place of joy, Darren. Isaiah, you need to get a bit more joy, Darren. We've come here so that Matt can become a Christian. And so that Darren can maybe get a bit more joy. Darren's got lots of joy. He was making a fool of my height last night. So, is that a baldy part of your head there? Oh! How does that work? Does that mean you're going to go more bald? Those whom the Lord has paid for and set free will return. They will come to Zion with singing. Joy that lasts forever will crown their heads. They will be glad and full of joy. Sorrow and sad voices will be gone. Lord, give Darren some hair. Come forth. Come out. We will be taught from Zion. This is a huge one. I love you. I love Darren. The only way I can be like this with him is because I love him. Love means you can mock them. We will be taught from Zion. Isaiah 35:10 says, those whom the Lord, that's the one I just read, moving on. Isaiah 2:3 says, many people shall come and say, come up, let us go up to the mountain. That's important, let us go up to the mountain. We're in days of ascension where we go up into the heavenly realms. Let us go up to the mountain. The mountain represents government. In the Old Testament, when Moses would meet God in the mountain, it wasn't just a natural mountain. It was a place of meeting with God himself because it's a governmental arena. So let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways. Do you realize we're in a day where there's many people across the earth are being taught in Zion by God himself? We're in days where we're ascending into that heavenly realm where we can learn how to grow hair. No, I'm joking. He made a fool of my size last night, so I can just get them back. Anybody else want to sew into Darren's hair? Oh, you can. You could use your beard and put it in his head. Anybody else want to sew into Darren? You're supposed to show your crown, Darren. There you go, Darren. You could go and get an operation now with this money. Oh, you could go and get an operation now. We can be taught in Zion. Do you know, I know that we've still got men teaching because I'm teaching now. And God will always use men. So don't think it means we're rebellious and you don't need any man, you don't need your pastor. I'm not saying that. But we, the mature sons, will be taught in heaven. The mature sons will be taught in Zion by God himself. There's a maturity coming where we will be taught by the Lord. And we're going to learn the ways of God. Do you know, sometimes we're just wanting to know about his power and his miracles and his signs and his wonders. And I want that, don't get me wrong. I want to see miracles and signs and wonders. But do you know, there's something even further than that where we can know the ways of God. We can walk in the ways of God. We can know God, his heart, his mind, and be taught in Zion by God himself as his friend. We can meet God face to face like Moses, but even greater than Moses because we do have Christ in us. Something greater. Moses didn't have that. Adam didn't have that. We have Christ in us, but we can also meet God face to face as well because John had Christ in him, but he also saw one in heaven and he fell before him as dead. And in Mount Zion, there's a generation who will be taught by the Lord himself. And it's available to all of us. None of us unqualified. Not Darren either. And the word of the Lord is going to flow from Zion. Isaiah 2, verse 23. Many people shall come and say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways. We shall walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. This heavenly realm is where we're going to be oracles. This is where we're going to carry the word of the Lord like this generation has never seen. Last night when you were playing that amazing sound, I felt the Lord say that there's coming a time again where men will tremble at the word of the Lord. There's coming a time again where we will come from that place in Zion and the word of the Lord will come with such force, such power, such glory that men again shall tremble. Like George Whitefield, before he even got on the stage, thousands and thousands of people would be trembling Unsaved people, not people who are charismatic, who know how it all works. Unsaved people in a field, trembling at the word, listening to every word, captivated. The word they used in those days was spellbound by the words of the man. Spellbound by the mysteries flowing from heaven. And we are going to see the prophetic word of the Lord coming again. But it comes from Zion. It comes as we access Zion beyond the veil in the governmental arena of heaven. The word of the Lord is coming again to America. And I tell you, this time, the world laughs at us sometimes and they won't listen. When the word of the Lord comes and people tremble, I tell you what, they won't laugh any longer. Because we're going to be shining ones. We're going to be ones so full of the glory that no one will laugh. They'll try and kill us like Jesus. But then we'll turn invisible and walk through them. Jeremiah 23:18 says, "But which of them has stood in the counsel of the Lord to see or hear his word? Who has listened and heard his word?" Who has stood in the council? Why is it that the prophets, and I'm not talking about bringing words of doom and gloom, I'm not talking about that, but I'm talking about bringing the word of the Lord with such power and glory. Why is it that standing in the council of the Lord seems to be that it was just for Old Testament prophets? Do you know there's coming a day where we will stand in the council of the Lord? If you had stood in my counsel. John, is it John Sanford? Have you heard of John Sanford? Do you know during the Cuban Missile Crisis, he was caught up to stand in the counsel of the Lord and he interceded in behalf of the earth? And through his intercession, because he stood in the counsel of the Lord, the Third World War was averted. There's a day here where God is calling men and women into the councils of the Lord. Do you know the true apostolic is not just going to be on earth making decisions? The true apostolic, the true governmental will be in the councils of heaven. The true apostolic will be with Jesus, the head of the church, the king, in the throne, in the governmental arena of heaven. We are going to access the councils of heaven. We must access the councils of heaven because the nations are in a absolute mess. Middle East is in a mess. Many nations are in a mess. We must consult the councils in heaven and take part in the councils in heaven. And it all comes from us accessing Mount Zion. Beyond the veil. Living beyond the veil. The ecclesia beyond the veil. Not earth to heaven, but heaven to earth. Jeremiah 23:22 says, "But if they had stood in my counsel, they would have proclaimed my words to my people and would have turned them from their evil ways and from their evil deeds." If they had stood in my counsel. That means they had the opportunity. That means, if means they should have. Doesn't it? If they had stood in my counsel, they would have turned the people away from their evil ways. That means they didn't, but it means they could have. Robert Henderson says that the courtrooms in heaven are open for everybody, but the councils are open to God's friends. Friendship with the Lord is the key. Friendship, do you know? In the past, we used to hear that intercessors could change God's mind. Remember Abraham interceding with God? Do you know, it's not intercessors that change God's mind. It's God's friends that change God's mind. And if you're his friend, he wants to call us into the councils in heaven because, do you know, God wants to release his plan for the earth, but he's looking for those who stand in the council. There's a book I recommended at the school, the supernatural school, called Standing in the Council of the Lord. What's his name, Jane? Carlton Kenny. Standing in the Council of the Lord. This is a true government that's coming, Darren. This is a true governmental realm where people will gather and will stand in that place together in the heavenly realms. And Christ will sit with us at a table. And together, we'll discuss together We'll get the mind of the Lord and the heart of the Lord for regions and nations and blueprints for regions and nations. Bring in the blueprints to whole regions. Not ideas, not just saying let's get together and try and do this or do that, but coming from that realm together. With burning hearts aflame, with our hearts on fire. Burning ones coming from the face of God, His presence standing before the God of all creation. On fire, a flame of fire coming from His counsel. If you had stood in my counsel. Job 15:8 says, were you listening at God's secret counsel? Were you? Were you? What would happen if we begin to listen to the counsels in heaven? Not just the wisdom of men, not just the wisdom of our intellect, of our modern culture, thinking we are quite intelligent compared to past cultures. We're not. We're not. That's why we need to die to what we think is right. That's why we need the spirit of wisdom. That's why we need the fullness of Christ. That's why we need to be in union with Him. There's a company of people on earth right now who will know how to go to the heavenly Zion, how to climb the secret stairs and hear the word of the Lord and release that word on the earth. Oracles are coming from Mount Zion. That might sound strange, but it's actually scriptural. 1 Peter 4:11. It says, if anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. Do you know the times for just sermons is over? Do you know we need to bring words from heaven, words from the heart of God, oracles for our generation, oracles who speak the word of the Lord to the United Kingdom, to the United States, to presidents, oracles who are burning flames of love, oracles who are completely yielded and surrendered, like Evan Roberts. Do you know, last night, Evan Roberts came here last night in the cloud of witnesses. When you were playing that amazing music, because the heartbeat of God was here, and it was like a prayer. I could hear a prayer, like Evan Roberts, when he was praying in Wales, he would say, send the Spirit more powerfully for Jesus' sake. And then he would pray again, send the Spirit more powerfully for Jesus' sake. And then he prayed, bend me, Lord. Bend me, Lord. Bend me, Lord. And we must cry, bend me, Lord. Bend me, Lord. We must be yielded to Him fully. We must speak as oracles. One Peter 4:11 says, if anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. Another place it says, men of old spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Do you know, we need to be so possessed by the Holy Spirit that we will be moved by Him. His words in us will be like a flame. His words in us will be like a fire. His words in us will be like a hammer. Do you know when Peter preached on the day of Pentecost, it says men's hearts were cut to the heart. Do you know when Charles Finney spoke and he said he wasn't preaching hell or anything like that. He was preaching the gospel, the good news of the gospel. He says, but he had to whisper because people's hearts were cut. He says people were slain in anguish and he wasn't preaching hell. He was preaching the good news. But people were cut. But I tell you what, the people then get really, truly saved. But we are going beyond that. And we are going to be oracles from heaven, bringing the word of the Lord from heaven. Here's an example of interaction with the councils in heaven. And you've all heard it before, Isaiah 6:1-8. And remember, I'm talking about Mount Zion. This is all in Mount Zion. It was in the year that King Uzziah died that I saw the Lord. He was sitting on a lofty throne. And the train of his robe filled the temple. Attending him were mighty seraphim, each having six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And they were calling out to each other, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of heaven's armies. The whole earth is filled with his glory." Their voices shook the temple to its foundation, and the entire building was filled with smoke. And this is the next part is where I want to talk about. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a burning coal he had taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. He touched my lips with it and said, "See, the coal has touched your lips. Now your guilt is removed and your sins are forgiven." Then I heard the Lord asking, "Whom shall I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us?" He, Isaiah, overheard the council meeting in heaven. And he heard them speaking, saying, "Who will go for us?" And you know, there's council meetings in heaven just now, and God is speaking, and we need to hear what the councils are saying. Can you imagine if Isaiah did not hear what was said in the councils of heaven? Can you imagine what would have happened if he didn't say, "Send me"? The councils in heaven are speaking and saying, who will go? Who will take the governmental realms of heaven to the earth? Who will bring the governmental realms of Zion? Who will begin to function in the courts? Who will become oracles of the Lord? Who will become messengers of his face? The councils in heaven are speaking. And if we don't say, "Here I am, Lord, send me," Isaiah heard them speaking. And God is releasing coals of fire to put on our lips, that we might bring the unadulterated word of the Lord. Whom will go? Laws, legislation will be released from Zion. Can you see how it's governmental? Isaiah 2 verse 23 says, "Many people shall come and say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways. We shall walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law." When Jesus said, "I will build my ecclesia," the ecclesia was actually the Greek legislator, the places where laws were passed. So the ecclesia is where laws are birthed. So the law will go forth from Zion. That's to do with the judicial governmental courtroom of heaven. And it will go forth from Zion in these days. Revelation 12:11 says, "And they overcome him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death." Do you know when we quote that scripture, when it says, "You will overcome by the word of your testimony," we think it means something like this, where you tell people about Jesus. Is that right? Do you know what it means? There's a generation coming, and we are that generation who will know how to overcome in the courtrooms in heaven. Why do I know it's the courtrooms in heaven? Where do you give your testimony? In the courtroom of heaven. Why is it we'll overcome by the blood? Because the blood speaks in Mount Zion. What does the blood speak? A better word than that of Abel. What does that mean? It means not guilty. It means forgiven. It's grace. It's the gospel. That's why the gospel is so important, because the blood qualifies us to go into the governmental realm of heaven. The blood speaks in Zion and says forgiven, qualified, not guilty. They will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony, and they love not their lives unto death. We must lay down what we think is right for everything that God wants to do. And that's why we need the blueprints from heaven. We must not just go by what we think is right. We need the blueprints. We must not love our lives, our ideas, our programs, our intellectual conclusions. And then we will overcome by the word of our testimony in the court, by the blood of the Lamb that says you're forgiven. by laying down our lives, our ideas, so that we can get the blueprints from heaven. That generation will overcome. And that generation will be given manna, secret, hidden manna. Mysteries revealed that have never been revealed for generations. Because we are overcomers. I'm just going to mention the courtroom just a wee bit, but Jane's going to go into more details. Because the courtroom is part of Mount Zion. The courtroom, the judge is there. It doesn't describe God as Father there, although He is our Father. It doesn't just say that He's Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. It says Judge. Why? Because it's the courtroom. Zechariah 3, this is an example of the courtroom. And He showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at His right hand to resist Him. Another version says, and Satan was the accuser. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke thee, O Satan, even the Lord that has chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is this not a brand plucked out of the fire? Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity to pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with a change of raiment. And I said, let them set a fair mitre upon his head. So they set a fair mitre upon his head and clothed him with garments, and the angel of the Lord stood by. Now listen to the next part. This is so important. And the angel of the Lord protested unto Joshua, saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways, and if you shall keep my charge, then you shall judge my house, and shall keep my courts. And I will give you places to walk amongst these that stand by. If we will walk in God's ways, do you know this scripture doesn't even say that we will be able to access the courts? It says He will give us charge of the courts. Do you know there's a generation who's not just going to access the courts? There's something beyond that. We are going to be given charge of the courts. Another version says that we will be given free access. Free access to the courts in heaven. Free access. Free access to the courts in heaven. And do you know you don't... People think you need to be so clean to go there or you'll be set on fire or something. Joshua the high priest was given Joshua the high priest went with dirty garments, and he was given new garments when he was there. So in other words, you don't need to get clean to go there. You go there and you'll get clean. Free access to the courts. If you will walk in my ways and keep my charge, you shall also judge my house and shall also keep my courts. I don't think we've even begun to walk in this. We are about to see a company of people who are really know, who really well know what it is to be judges and kings and priests on the earth. Does Paul not say we will judge angels? But it does take us being totally united to Christ. Otherwise, we'll be like the disciples and we will want to call down fire on villages. And Jesus will say, you don't know what spirit you are. If we're not careful, we'll prophesy things, calling down fire, calling down earthquakes and places. And Jesus will say, you do not know what spirit you are. We need to be in union with His love. We need to be motivated, fully possessed with His love. We need to be completely surrendered to grace and His goodness. We need to be in union with Him so that we will judge correctly. Jesus said, you should not judge your brother until you take the speck out of their eye and take the plank out of your own eye. But He did not say that you can't judge. He said, take the plank out of your eye. Then you will see rightly. We are to judge, but unfortunately most of us can't, because we're judging through our own opinions, our own hearts, our own rejection, our own political ideology, our own religious denomination. Listen, we need to die to all of that so that we have the unadulterated will of the Lord flowing through us. Then we can judge correctly. Then we can do what the Lord wants us to do in nations, in regions, in countries. Not my will, but thy will be done. Jesus could not do anything unless he saw his Father doing it. Why do we think we can do anything? Quite a bit more and you'll get new hair. And I'm not going to go into the end times and all of that and what you believe. But this revelation is for now. And you might ask, how have we not heard about this before? Like Mount Zion and going to heaven. I'll read this to you. Isaiah 2, verse 1 to 3. Verse 2. Now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it. Then it says, many people shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways. We shall walk in his paths, for out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Now it shall come to pass in the latter days, they shall say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord. Why is it coming now? It shall come to pass in the latter days, they shall say, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord. Where is Zion? We have come to Mount Zion. We have come to this place, Mount Zion. The Old Testament was a type and shadow of what is reality now for us in the heavenlies. In the latter days it shall come to pass. The revelation is flowing. The books are open. The scrolls are open. They're not hidden any longer. And it's a generation be called into the Mount Zion, the governmental realm of heaven, where we can legislate in the heavens, become judges and kings. Judges and kings, legislators. Under the full stature of Christ, under his headship, under the Spirit of the Lord, walking in the full seven spirits of God, wisdom and understanding, counsel and might, knowledge and the fear of the Lord. Do you know, William Branham said there was a day coming. God showed him, it was a story to do with a squirrel. And he was meditating on the scripture that says, you shall say to this mountain, be thou removed, and it shall be removed. And God told him, what do you want? And that day he was out hunting squirrels. And he said, well, could I have a squirrel? And he asked God to where the squirrel would come, and then he shot it because he was hunting. So the second time, he made it really quite difficult for God and said, I want the squirrel to do all these different things. And then the squirrel did exactly what he said. And then the third time, he made it impossible for God and made the squirrel do all these things, and he shot it. And then God said to him, there's coming a generation. Because that squirrel was created, by the way, by the words of his mouth. As an oracle speaking, he said, there's a generation coming that when they speak, even matter will be created. That when we speak, mountains shall be removed. But I tell you, we've not had this kind of authority and power before because we've not been able to handle it. Because we've not been under the full union with Christ. We've not died to self completely. When I say die to self, I'm not even talking about sin necessarily. I'm talking about, listen, sometimes good is the enemy of best. Not necessarily sin. I'm not talking about sin. I'm talking about yielding fully to the Holy Spirit. Going for the best. Going for the fullness. Going for tabernacles. Going for habitation, not visitation. Yielded fully to his mind. Yielded fully to his will. And in that day, there will be a generation who know how to engage Mount Zion, who will stand as oracles, who will stand in the courtroom, who will take charge of his court. So by faith, when we go to Zion, when we ascend those secret stairs, we encounter the King. Number one, the King. Number two, the judge in the court system of heaven is there. Number three, the joy of the Lord. Number four, teaching from the Lord himself. Number five, the word of the Lord and the secret counsels are there. Six, the blood speaks in our behalf there. Seven, the angelic realms there. Seven, eight, Jesus is there. Jesus is the number. Nine, the assembly of those registered in heaven there, the ecclesia. 10, the spirits of righteous men who have been made perfect as the cloud of witnesses. Do you know when it says, if you're born again, you will see? Is it such a surprise that if we're supposed to see, that we would see the cloud of witnesses? Jesus said, unless you're born again, you will not see. Jesus said, you need eye salve for your eyes so that you may see. If we are supposed to see, and if we're in Mount Zion, and if Mount Zion's in heaven, is it such a surprise we see the cloud of witnesses? Is it such a surprise we see angels? Is it such a surprise that we see Jesus? Is it such a surprise we see the court? Is it such a surprise we see the judge? The Mount Zion generation will function from heaven to earth. They will have intimate fellowship with the King of Zion. They will be marked by the joy of the Lord. They will be taught by the Lord himself. They will be overcomers because of the blood of the Lamb. They will be part of the court system of heaven. They will speak as oracles. They will take part in the secret councils of heaven. And they will deliver the plumb line word of the Lord to the earth. The Mount Zion generation. Matthew 16, verse 18 to 20 says, and I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of heaven, and whoever shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Jesus said, I will give you the keys of heaven. What do you do with keys? You open a door. Where does the door go? The keys are the keys of heaven. Jesus said, I'll give you keys to open the door to go into heaven. He said, I will build my ecclesia. That's the Greek word. The ecclesia was the Greek legislator. In other words, I will build my government. He said, I will build my government. Then he says, the gates of hell shall not prevail against us. The gates is where the government of a city was. So Jesus was saying, I will give you the keys to open a door to heaven. You can go into heaven, and when Jesus builds this ecclesia, the legislator, the government of God, then the government of hell cannot prevail against this. Then he said, whatever's loosed from heaven will be loosed on the earth. That's talking about loosening and binding of contracts. That's legal language. So in other words, we need to get legal things done in the heavenlies, done in the courtroom. Binding contracts. We've been trying to bind demonic beings and principalities and powers on this level. But I tell you what, when we get things done there, no weapon formed against us can prosper. No, Satan cannot come against the true ecclesia of God. When we begin to function in the heavenly realm as the true ecclesia that's in Mount Zion, then we can get binding and contracts loosed from heaven. But it all happens as we go beyond the veil. It all happens as we become God's friend. As God's friends, we'll be called into the councils of heaven. We can all come before the throne of grace boldly, but it's his friends that are called into the councils. God is looking for friends, but he's looking for the willing. And it's the blood that qualifies. It's grace. Grace unto this generation. Grace, grace, grace is not just God's mercy. Grace is God's empowerment. So if we need to overcome anything, ask for grace. Why? Grace gives you the power to overcome. Grace enables you to go to the courtroom. Grace enables you to be governmental. Grace enables you to be an oracle. Grace enables you to overcome in the councils in heaven. Grace enables this nation to be great again. Amen. One more scripture. That's a good noise. I like that noise. That's a good sign. This is Isaiah. Isaiah 33. I'm not going to read the whole thing, just the bottom verse. And it says, Isaiah, and it's, what Isaiah was that again? Forget. Verse 24, and it says, no one living in Zion will say, I am ill. I want to do a quick activation, right? How much time do we have? Hundreds of time. And I want to step into Mount Zion, right? And in particular, for health, right? Because it says not one person in Zion will say they are ill. So let's just stand up. Remember, to access heaven, to access Mount Zion, to access beyond the veil, is all by faith. And actually, the truth is, you have come to Mount Zion, so the truth is, you're already there. We just don't realize it. So sometimes we just take a step forward just to help our minds grasp the reality of where we really are. So take a physical step forward. But you have drawn near to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, heavenly Jerusalem, to countless angels in festival gathering, to the assembly of God's firstborn children who are in heaven, the ecclesia, to God the judge of all, to the spirits of the righteous who have been made perfect, it's a cloud of witnesses. To Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant. And to the sprinkled blood that speaks better than that, than Abel's blood. Father, thank you that we have stepped into Mount Zion, the governmental arena of heaven. Thank you, Lord God, we come here with a thankful heart. We thank you, Lord God, that we are surrounded by joyful angels. That we are surrounded here right now with the cloud of witnesses. Thank you that Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, is here. And thank you that the blood speaks and says, forgiven, not guilty. And thank you that the judge is here. And Father, I bring before you your own word that says, that would come a day when people will say in Zion that not one person is sick amongst us. So I'm asking you as a judge today that you will heal everyone in here today. Lord, let us begin to move into that realm where sickness cannot dwell. Because Lord, we are not dwelling on earth any longer. We are dwelling in Mount Zion beyond the veil. So Lord, I'm asking you to judge sickness. Wherever sickness is in here today, Lord, judge sickness in me. Judge diabetes, Lord. judge migraines, judge cancer, every disease, Lord, every sickness. I'm asking today that you judge it. And Lord, I ask that you continue to give revelation to everyone here that we need to begin to function from Mount Zion, to function as kings and priests, to function as oracles, to function beyond the veil, but more than that, give everyone, Lord God, a call into the secret place to be your friend. And then as your friends, may we be called into the councils like John Sanford. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
We're going to take a 10-minute break, and so let's just come back at 11:20, if that's good. And then we'll continue with Jane. Awesome. Stevie, thank you so much for that message. Really, really outstanding.
The second part of our session is now beginning. Please come into the building. Please come into the building. Please have a seat. Please refrain from talking. If in the case of an emergency, there's an exit to your right, an exit to the left, and there is a flotation device under your seat. Please turn off your cell phones. If your cell phone rings during this session, you will be ejected out of your seat. In love.
This is going to be a lot of fun. Man, it's such an honor to have Stephen and Jane here with us this weekend. And this has been a long time. We've just been sitting and waiting on this for quite a long time. And it's so exciting that we're actually here. We're in it. We're actually in the same room with Stevie and with Jane. This is actually happening right now. If you're watching live right now online, this is actually live. This is actually happening. This ain't no joke. I'm really, that last session was just off the charts, and just excited for what the Lord's going to do in this next session. Father, we just thank you so much for what you're entrusting to us, and we just thank you, Father, for the heart to receive and the faith to believe, and we just thank you for this information, Father, that's going to be massaged into our hearts so it can become revelation. And a reality that we can actually walk in. So, Father, we just thank you so much for just the courage and the humility to engage with your truth in this session. And we don't pretend to be anything that we're not. We just we gather as sons and daughters on the earth, Father, and with a certain level of gravity and intentionality in our hearts, and knowing that you're calling us up into places of greatness to reveal and represent your greatness on the earth. So, Father, we thank you for that honor, and we just say we love you, and we thank you for your presence that's just manifest here in this room, just your peace and your glory that's been here all morning. We thank you for that, in Jesus' name, amen. Would you welcome Jane this morning?
Thank you, Jesus. It's really good to be here. Last time I was here, I fell off my platform, so let's not hope my platform shoes that happens this time. Yeah, I fell off my shoes last time and hurt my leg, hurt my knee. I was stomping up and down, preaching the gospel and talking about my favorite Jesus. And I sort of tripped like that and fell off my shoe and hurt my knee. Thank you, Jesus. But I love my platforms. I like my high heels. So you girls. Come on. Yeah, Stevie likes them too. He borrows all my shoes. We're the same size. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not going there. Thank you, Jesus. So, Father, I just thank you, Lord. We just love you. We thank you that you first loved us. Father, I just ask today that you'd speak through me with clarity. Lord, I ask that you would just bring what you want to bring. I just lay down all my own preconceived ideas, my own control, my own selfish ambition, my own selfishness and pride and religious DNA. Father, I just repent right now and I come before you in humility and ask that you would just use me as an empty vessel, but a vessel full of love, full of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. So what I feel like the Father's told me to do today is we're going to do a bit of an in-depth. Stevie's already touched on the courtrooms and the function and who's there and how we step in and how we step out. So I'm going to do a bit more in-depth. It's more like a teach than a preach. And we're going to look at lots of scriptures and a much more in-depth. And then the Lord's already been downloading to me in the night about we're going to do an actual court case. So the plan is we're going to write. I've already got some ideas of what the Lord's been showing me, and I've been speaking to Sandy and Darren, what's going on in the region and in the nation here. And we're just going to write out a proper case on here so you've got it to help you in future. And what I want you to do, I want you to really follow these instructions, though, but I don't want to sound bossy, but you'll see why when we get to the end of the case, why we keep it quite tight, how we're going to do it. So I'm going to write down, first of all, like point one, say it was, Lord, we repent of idolatry in this region. You then call out what you feel the Lord's showing you as well. So I'll have two at a time to come out to the microphone. You've got to keep it really short. And you're going to repent of what the Lord's stirred in your heart. But it will be to do with the point that we've already raised, because the Lord's already spoken to us in advance of what we're going to do. The key thing in a court case is repentance. So I don't want you to come up and decree and start saying, Lord, I thank you for this, I thank you for that. We are repenting. The Lord's going to really stir our hearts right now. Stevie's already laid the foundation. It was epic what you shared this morning. But we're going to come. We're going to shift things in this nation today, because this is 11:11. This is the time. We're already beyond the time. There's an urgency in the spirit to see things land. You know me. I'm quite a whacked up, jacked up, crazy party girl. And I really love Jesus. But I'm really feeling that governmental realm here this weekend since we got here. I really feel like there's a bridge, not a gap, but the Lord's already built a bridge between you and the governmental realms in the heavenly realms. You're already going there. But it's like that baby when you're in labor and you're pushing away, and you mums know this. And you think this is never going to end, and you reach the point where you've had so much gas and air and maybe pethidine, you think the baby's head's not going to crown. And you just give that last push and the baby's born and joy comes in the morning. And there's that joy, and then you forget the pain within weeks, and you just enjoy this gorgeous baby that smells lovely. And you rub your lips on the furry, velvety skin of their head, and they smell gorgeous, and they snuggle in. We're going to land somewhat today in the nation, in this region. Because you already think you're going places. You're seeing healing, signs, wonders break out. It's epic. I've been watching you on live feed. I'm super excited. I heard Darren preach a few weeks ago, and it was so intense. He was talking about the grumpy times in his life and what a gift his wife for him and his children. I was packing my suitcase, and I just wept my heart out. He's amazing. He's got the sweetest heart of humility and love I've met in many people.
He's very humble and proud of it.
He's a gift to your nation, him and Andrew and his family. And we need to honor that daily. The work that people put in, from the person that cleans the toilets to the person that's running around like a lunatic answering emails and preparing messages for you and the media, all of you. I really honor you today, and I thank God for you. We feel totally humbled to be here. Since the time we flew in, we keep saying the same thing, Stevie and I, when we've gone for lunch and we're chatting. We just feel the sweetness and the humility here, and God's going to break out in power. Because that's the only place he can land his government on, are those that go lower, the servant. The door is in the floor. You look at Heidi Baker, what she's accomplished in her life already. Because out of that, wow, out of that humility and mercy and love, the Lord lands his government on. He's not looking for the proud, he's looking for the humble. But he's looking for the courageous. We have not walked this way before. Be very, very courageous, because heaven is really cheering you on. You are history makers. You were born for now, for such a time as this. And those of you who think you're a mistake, that is a lie from the pit of hell. That is the accuser, Satan, in the courts of heaven accusing you today. And you go, yeah, I'm human, but you know what? I'm not human anymore. I'm a life giver. I'm a light being. I am full of life, full of glory, full of Jesus. You are full of the Spirit of the living God, the Holy Spirit. The power that you carry in your little finger can change a nation in a day. Isaiah 66, can a nation be shaped and changed in a day? Yes and amen. So are we up for this? Thank you, Jesus. Wow. Hey. Okay. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. I keep feeling this, like, I've just put this out there. It's almost like there's a John G. Lake presence here that you're going to see the hospitals emptied. You're going to see so much glory, so many signs and wonders. I keep feeling that. Last time I came here 3 years ago, I felt it, but it's even stronger now. That you're going to have that sick-free zone. But you won't just be known for your miracle signs and wonders. One thing, you'll be known for the fivefold, sixfold, sevenfold. Whatever fold's not even appeared here. It's all in all. I can really feel that power growing and moving and swirling around. I saw a swirling cloud last night. All night there was this swirling invitation to go up, 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 up in the whirlwinds to the throne room and to see what's going on there. Thank you, Father, for that corporate ascension. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. Thank you, God. Yay. Wow. Well, okay, let's go. I believe that more effort without additional wisdom usually produces tiredness and fatigue and weariness. What we need, as Stevie's been saying for the last 2 days and in the school, what we need is not more effort necessarily, but we need Song of Solomon 2:14, the secret of the stairs. We need to discover new dimensions to unlock the mysteries of God and the secrets of heaven. Striving just produces frustration and tiredness, and we get fed up and we lose track and we get apathetical. The mindset that we have in the church is flawed. Let's just get over it. Let's just say, Lord, forgive us. It's flawed. It doesn't produce many results. But you know what? We think if we go long and hard enough and keep pushing it, some magical thing's going to happen and it's going to appear. No, it's not. Because it says 1 John 5:14-15. One of the crucial steps for effective prayer is to understand simply the will of God and come in agreement with it. Not our self-efforts, not what we think. Put it aside. Kill yourself right now. Kill your own thinking. Just kill it. Just get it over with. Just die to yourself. Because we have a confidence between God and us that he is all omnipotent, that he is all powerful, that he is all knowing. And it's simply, we just go to him and ask him and we wait on him. We wait on him. We tarry. That's an old fashioned word. We tarry in the glory. We wait on him. We need to shut up. Literally. We need to be quiet and just wait on him. Is this okay? Revelation 19:11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True. Do you not think he's not going to speak to you? And in righteousness, he judges and wages war in the courts in heaven. And we all know what the courts in the natural earth are. They're for justice and judgment. The judges to speak a judicial activity, a discussion or a petition or a request. We go in there and we petition and we request on behalf of the things the Lord has already shown us or stirred in our hearts. And I'll share some stories of when the Lord stirred my heart to do a court case by faith. I didn't have a clue, could see nothing. I had absolutely no understanding, but by faith, led by the Spirit of the living God, going under the government of heaven, I stepped in by faith in my bedroom on the mountain on a pouring, wet, cold, windy day in the UK. And I've seen governmental figures changed and exposed the cruelty and the abuse and the sexual activity they were doing in my nation. It takes one. I am probably the least of the least in the kingdom. I couldn't read till I was 12, super dyslexic. We used to joke, me and Stevie, when Justin would get us up and share stories or help in the meetings, I'd be shaking in my shoes and keep running to the restroom. It was so bad. I was so nervous. And I thought, I get all my words wrong when I read. Because everything's jumbled and backwards. But one day the Lord said, I've chosen you because you are so unqualified. You are super qualified. So judges, out of this decision, the verdict is made, and you can check this out. I'm going to give you loads of scriptures. You'll know it's in the Bible by the time I've finished. Luke 18:8. I tell you that I will bring about justice for you quickly. I tell you that I will avenge them speedily. Righteousness, Matthew 6. Yeshua never placed prayer on the battlefield. He spoke through flowing thoughts out of relationship with the Father to the Son. You have a relationship with Jesus, your mediator, your intercessor, your barrister, your friend before God Almighty. And he has filled you with the Spirit, God's own Spirit is in there. It possesses you. It gives you no choice. It overmasters you. Stay on the message, Jane. Don't sidetrack. Pray for me, Stevie. I don't get sidetracked. Yeah. Raise the dead, heal the sick, because this is the year of the Lord. Dead raises, full of faith, full of love, full of trust, full of dumanous, electric, fire, flaming, flowing power! Right, understanding the books and the scrolls in heaven. Daniel 7:10. Protocol is key. Now, I am super, is this word okay, crap at protocol. I'm one of these. That's why they used to call me Schroeder. If the door won't open, I'm going to kick it open. I'm like, I'm going to go there. I'm going to be aggressive and open this, because it says in Scripture, the aggressive take it by force. I had to learn to be Jesus, stay with the Lord, sit and wait upon him and be quiet. And not telling what I think's going on. That was super hard for me. Because my husband left when my children were teenagers. And I had to have 3 jobs and bring them up on my own. I worked 3 jobs to pay my mortgage and bring my kids up. So I'm used to being superwoman. You know what I mean? So I had to learn the lesson. That's not how it works in the courts of heaven. It's all about Yeshua. It's all about him. It's not about how much I can persuade him to do what I think he should be doing. Die to self. Die is the only way. It was painful, but I'm on the journey. Daniel 7:10. The main objective is to get what it is in heaven to manifest on the earth. But did you know, people ask me all the time, how do I open my scroll, what's in my book? Well, if you worship the Lord, he'll show you. Number one. But it says in his word, in Hebrews 10:5-7. Then I said, behold, this is Jesus talking, I have come in the volumes of the book. It is written of me to do the will of God. To do your will, O God. That is the starting point for the courts, for me. Anything God ordained is first written in the books of the scrolls. Jesus had 3 books. His life book, his destiny, and his relationship with his Father. says it in the Bible. And the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. He has given you his Word to become flesh. You are his living Word. You are his living epistles. You are his living scrolls. You are his living books. You know why? Because Jesus is within you. And if he has three books, you have three books. If he has a flaming sword coming out of his mouth, so do you. If he's full of light, if he raised the dead, healed the sick, changed the water into wine, what are you meant to do? I know where I'm going. Where are you going? I love this in the Voice translation. The voice took on the flesh and became human and chose to live alongside us. Holy Spirit, Paracletio, rub shoulders with us, Comforter. We have seen him enveloped in undeniable splendor, the one true Son of the Father, evidence in the perfected balance of grace and truth. Undeniable splendor. Jesus has a book in heaven to fulfill kingdom purposes on earth, and so do you. It is the truth, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. Are you the way, the truth, and the life? Are you pointing? Are you a signpost to Jesus? Are you a signpost to the nations? Wow. So, thank you, Father. So we're going to talk a little bit about the functions in the courtroom. I'm not looking at Steve, he gets me really wild. The blood speaks on our behalf in the councils of God, in the courts of heaven. And as Stevie shared, that to be, you know, there, I believe there are two different places. There are the courts where we all can go. We can go by faith and step in and petition there with the things that have stirred in our heart, that the Lord has laid on our hearts. But the councils, we have to be a friend of God, and he invites us in there. So we're back to the key thing is intimacy with God himself. As our Father, as our King of Kings, of Lord of Lords, of our majestic God, mighty in his name. But in the courts of heaven, he is not Abba, he is not Father, he is the judge. He has the last say. I believe in this season, the Lord was speaking to me in the night, that in this season that we have come all too familiar with the Lord, mighty God. Yes, he is Abba, he is our Father, but he is also the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we have stretched grace so far out that it's okay to have adulterous affairs, it's okay to be a homosexual. It's okay for these practices, which I believe are not God's perfect plan for our lives. And if we struggle with these things, we need to cleanse our bloodlines. Is this okay? Thank you, Jesus. We have to come before the Lord in true repentance and in grace. Am I in trouble now? Oh, God. Thank you, Jesus. Wow, help me, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, thank you, Father. Thank you, God. And when we go into the courtroom, we go in with dirty rags and filth, and we are just, you know? But we don't go in there worrying about how clean we are, because when we go in there, we get absolutely cleansed, absolutely purified. Because we just agree with our accuser in there, Satan. He's always in there accusing us. And it says, agree with him quickly. I just go, yeah, I did it. I'm sorry, forgive me, I repent. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. Thank you, Father. So the blood speaks on our behalf in the councils of the Lord, because we are co-crucified with Christ. No longer I, but Christ lives in me, in you. Two hands, one nail. The testimony means to give judicial witness, the activity of a petition or your requesting, out of which a decision will be made. Jesus, from his position as high priest and mediator, will testify on your heart behalf in the courts. And some call it the Sod, the Yasad. That means to sit together and to consult in the councils of the Lord. Our identity. Joshua was a mortal man. He was granted access, free access, in and out to function in the courts of heaven. You have complete, utter free access by faith, by the blood of Jesus Christ, because his blood has a voice in the courtrooms of heaven. It speaks on our behalf. It's very important to walk or conduct ourselves in holiness before the Lord in the authorities of the courts of heaven. When we walk in a manner worthy of him, heaven recognizes you in the courts. So holiness and purity before him is a key factor. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. Titus 1, 11 to 12. The joy of the Lord is our strength, but I believe when we're going into the courts of heaven, and we're going into the governmental realms, that righteousness and purity and godliness and holiness is key. Notice that Joshua, the high priest, this is a fantastic scripture. And it says courts, plural. If you walk in my ways and if you will perform my service, then you will also govern my house and also have charge of my courts. Oh my goodness, you have authority there. You have a place there. There's a seat for you there. You don't just go there and petition all the time. You eventually become a judge in there. I will grant you free access among these who are standing here. They are the cloud of witnesses, the angelic, the church of the firstborn, the ecclesia, the blood of Jesus, the voice of finance in there. The good news is we can come boldly before the throne of grace. Let us therefore become boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help us in times of need. Hebrews 4:16. Everything we deal with on a personal or family level can be brought into the throne of grace. Here we obtain mercy, forgiveness for all our needs. All our needs. Matthew 16:18-19. And I also say to you, Peter, I love this fantastic example of scripture. He messed up all the time. I mess up all the time. But it says, and I also say to you, Peter, on this rock I will build my church. I will build my ecclesia. My will be done on the earth as it is in heaven. And I, the gates of Hades shall not prevail. The gates of hell, Satan's accusations will not prevail. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on the earth will be loosed in heaven. I believe this is talking about the heavenly ecclesia, about the church of Jesus Christ, because you are his church. You are his body. You are his resting place. You are the government. Where's he going to rest his head? Where's he going to lay his government? On you and me. On your children's children's children. The accuser, Satan, he comes to accuse us. But if we confess our sins, it says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, it's simple, easy, get it over with. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all, A double capital LL, all. Put a ring around it in your Bible when you're reading it. Every time you see all and in him, I live and move and have my being. All of heaven is cheering you on. In all, in him. I love in all. Wow, to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Wow. Zechariah 3. Joshua, the high priest, was standing before the angel of the Lord. Who was the angel of the Lord? Christoph? Jesus. Jesus, I believe, was stood next to Joshua in the courts of heaven. Because he stood by Joshua as Satan was accusing him. He stood on the right hand of Joshua. And you think of the scriptures that talk about the son of my right hand. Benjamin, the son of my right hand. Sandy, the son of my right hand. Ryan, the son of my right hand. Wow. But the Lord said to Satan, I, the Lord, rebuke you, Satan. I reject you. You are fired. I love Alan Sugar. You are fired. So they put a clean turban, a clean mitre, a clean mindset on his head, put clothes on him, and the angel of the Lord stood by, and Jesus stood by and admonished Joshua, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, if you walk in my ways and if you keep my commands, then you shall also judge my house. And likewise have charge of my courts, and I will give you places to walk among these who stand here. And you think about who was standing in the courts of heaven. You have a place in the courts of heaven. You have a place with the cloud of witnesses. Once I start talking about the angels and the cloud of witnesses, they start looking in, I can see them. They're swirling in, they're coming in. Last night, I saw Smith Wigglesworth come and sit right next to Stevie, and he was rocking backwards and forwards, interceding on behalf of your nation. Because Stevie's honoured him in his heart. I was in a meeting recently, and Reese Howell appeared to just about everybody in the meeting. And he was a famous intercessor. A Bible college in Wales, we went there the other week. And he changed the course of one of the world wars. So who's possessing you today? Who's in full possession of your life? Wow. Simon, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you to sift you like wheat. Oh, freaky. But I have prayed for you. I have prayed for this church. I have prayed for Seattle. I have prayed for America. He is praying for you right now. He is the great intercessor, the great high priest. I am praying for you right now. That your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen each other. Strengthen the brethren. But the Lord stood for Peter in the courts in heaven. You know, often in the courts of heaven, when we get in there, we are triggered instantly. Do not be concerned. Often, it will trigger centuries, perhaps, going back, even millenniums, of stuff generational stuff in your maternal and your paternal side, your mum and dad's line, your family lines. Personal stuff. But the Lord has come to blot it out. Because his blood, his voice speaks there to cleanse our blood if we agree with our adversary, Satan, and repent. He will show us major stuff that will be dealt with in a day, in a second, in an instant, in a twinkling of an eye. I'm not saying having inner healing and ministry and doing personal bloodline cleansing. That's epic. I've done loads of it. But in the courts of heaven, repentance is key. Mindset shifts. Put a clean turban on his head. That means a clean mindset. Colossians 3, set your mind on things above, not on the earth realm. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. And I can prove this in scripture because it says, I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake. And I will not remember your sin. Put me in remembrance. Let us contend together. State your case that you may be acquitted. Your first father sinned, and your mediators have transgressed against me. Therefore, I will profane the princes of the sanctuary, and I will, Jacob, to curse the Israel. I am the God of Israel, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. The mediator, who's in the courtrooms? Let's go into it a bit more detail. Mediators is a legal term. It means legal transaction. God is faithful and just. His covenant with us to help keep us his loving nature through Jesus Christ is blood. It's all about his love. It's all about his cleansing blood. It's all about who we are in Christ. And you being dead in your trespasses and uncircumcision of the flesh. He has made you alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirement that was against you. Wow. Stuff that's been written against you, there's a big fat eraser in there and it just, it's gone. Because it is nailed to the cross. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in all our sin. Colossians 2, 13 to 15. I love that scripture. Washed, cleansed as white as snow, forgiven all our sin. Disarming principalities and powers just by repenting. It's just nuts, isn't it? The power of repentance is unbelievable. So what we bind, meaning contract, and we loose to dissolve a contract. And in the courts of heaven, we're binding and loosing contracts. So we need to have heard what Holy Spirit is telling us. We need discernment. We need revelation and understanding. Because when you speak in there, you are binding and loosening. You are producing a contract, and you are sometimes dissolving contracts. But you have come. Stevie's favorite scripture. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly, to the church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God the judge of all. The nations may wage against each other, but the Lord sits on his mountain and he laughs. Who's in control? Jesus, and to the blood sprinkled that speaks better things than that of the blood of Abel. Mount Zion, Sinai, the place where the law was given to bring us to Christ, not a place of death, a place where David offered up perpetual 24/7 worship. Let's just have a little look, a little more in depth at Zion and the place where David was stirred in his heart by God for the 24/7 worship. King David's commissioned worship to cultivate, to host the presence of the Lord. So primary from that praise, he could govern the nations. Shall I read that again? This is what I believe. And then I read it in a book as well, so I really thought, oh man, I'm getting some good revelation here, Lord. David commissioned worship to cultivate, to host the presence of the Lord. So primary from the presence of the Lord in 24/7 worship on the mountain of government, he could govern the nation with holiness and purity of heart and with power and authority and discernment and revelation and understanding and favor and clarity. That's why Darren is such a worshiper. That's where his place of government comes from. That's where his sphere of influence comes from. Praising the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Thank you, Jesus. Out of worship is to flow the governmental authority of God through his ecclesia, the Church of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He loves the church. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. Wow. When we worship, there is to be a rearranging of heavenly or spiritual realms until heaven is allowed to enter earth. This is what Psalm 110, 1-2 declares. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord shall send the rod of your strength out of Zion to rule in the midst of your enemies. Notice what is declared about Zion. The rod of the strength of the Lord will flow out of Zion and cause the enemies of God to be subdued. The purpose, I believe, the activity of Zion is rulership and governmental authority. The activity of Zion is to worship, to allow worship. Wow, Jesus. Man, I'm starting to see Moses and Abraham's come into the room right now, the father of the nation, because we're talking about governmental realms. There's a court in heaven where Abraham resides there, and he leads the courts in there, and he's coming now. He's really interested in what we're doing. Oh, Jesus. Ah! I need your help. The purpose and the activity of Zion is rulership and governmental authority. The activity of Zion is worship that allows the Lord's rod of strength to be wielded against his enemies. When the word of the Lord says, we have come to Mount Zion, it is saying we have come to this governmental place in God. We have been privileged out of that place of intimate worship with the Lord to govern, co-govern with him, to sit on the mountain with him. We are no longer at the mountain of Sinai, but we now are the mountain of Zion, the place of governmental authority and power. The rearrangement. Your worship is rearranging the atmosphere. Your worship is bringing governmental authority. And we worry, I'm not good enough, I can't do this, I don't get it. So what? We step in by faith. I'm cleansed instantly. I repent. And then the presence of the Lord God Almighty speaks on your behalf as you present your case. Thank you, God. Isaiah 2, 1 to 4. Wow. Not by might, but by the Spirit of the Lord, through faith and grace and mercy. The word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. Now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountain and shall be exalted above the hills. The governmental courts of heaven, the governmental places are exalted above the hills and the mountains of the earth. And all the nations shall flow to it. All the nations. The all in all. Inclusion. Eclectic. Many people shall come to say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of God of Jacob. And he will teach us his ways. He will teach us in the courts. He will release his mentors and tutors to us. His angels. He will draw natural people on the earth to us to teach us and help us. Because I'm in you and you're in me. And I'm in Jesus and he's in me. And we're in each other. There's no isolation. This is not a one-man show. Those days are done. He will teach us his ways and we will walk in his paths, in his shadows, like the rabbis did. His wing, his shadow, his grace and love and mercy. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and rebuke many people. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Take heart, the Lord your God will discipline the nations in the courts of heaven. I believe this scripture wholeheartedly, that a day is coming where there won't be tanks and guns and swords, but the land will be full of singing and beauty and joy and love and friendship. And I believe that is one of the purposes in the courts, to take in the wars and the terror and the terror attacks and all that's going on across our nations. But for me, it always begins with what stirs my heart. We can pray for millions of things. Every day there's something on the news, isn't there? But it's what stirs your heart. That is on your scroll. So one day when we had Ian Clayton and he was speaking on the courts, it seemed so complicated to me. I am such a simple thinker. But I understood that if you repent, you go in by faith, present your case, it's okay. So I go into my room at home up on the mountain and I step in and I say, Lord, I watched the news today and some women in my nation has been exposed, terrible atrocities to women, abuse to girls and to women. Lord, it has really stirred my heart. I just want to cry all the time. So you said there's this place called the courts in heaven. I don't know what it looks like. I've looked up the scripture, so I'm going to believe now that if I step in by faith, that you're going to help me. That's exactly what I did. And I said, Lord, I just ask you now. I knew the word what petition meant. I've already been through divorce court, so I had an idea how it worked, even though it's a little bit different. And I just said, Lord, I repent where a thought has ever come into my head, abuse against a man, where I ever thought a negative thought against a man on this earth, because that will stop me having a place in the courts of heaven. Now, nobody taught me this. I just knew that. Lord, I repent and I forgive them. I did it with gritted teeth because really in my heart, I was struggling. So then I went in again a few days later on in my bedroom by faith. Something stirred my heart again. A young girl of 12 had been attacked on a bus in India. I can't even begin to tell you what happened to it. It was so bad. And so yet again, I came in for on behalf of this young girl. By faith, Lord, I repent. I forgive the men that did it. Man, that was hard. I want to get my sword out, fly in the spirit, and chop off their heads. So I said, Lord, I repent. And I really meant it, though. Help me, help me. Months went past, nothing happened. Back again, went in again. And I'd read this article about these young men that for years and years had been abused by a member of our parliament in the UK. Went in for that again, repenting. More and more stuff became in my heart. I didn't read a lot more then because I sort of knew how it worked then for me. I wasn't really worried. I told a really good friend of mine in Cardiff what had happened, and he was like, I'm not sure you followed the protocol, but that's okay. He didn't really tell me off. He just was a bit, oh, Jane, I hope you haven't done anything you shouldn't, because he knows what I'm like. So when I'm really focused on something, I am focused. So anyway, I think it was about 5 months later on, Ian comes to the conference in. We had hosted him every year in Cardiff. Didn't know him that well. He'd been about 3 years and he scared me silly. I used to have nightmares when he left. He laughs about it now. It was just my DNA. My stuff needed cleansing. And he came in and he's like, where's Jane? And I used to work full time then. So even though I led the intercession and the ministry time at our meetings, I used to work in the day because I had no money. I'm not saying I wasn't living by faith. I just didn't have any money. It just didn't pop at that time. And I now know why, you know, you work out what's going on down the road. And he said, what have you been doing? I went, oh, it's not to do with the court case, is it? And he went, what have you been doing? I went, well, I prayed for these women in Cardiff. Then I prayed for this girl in India. Then I had to repent for these men. I wanted to kill them in my heart. I felt murder. I had to repent. And he's like, good job, Jane. Good job. He said, because I was in some of the high courts in heaven. I'm like, courts? He goes, yeah, courts. He said, and this case came up from this woman in Cardiff. And he goes, I knew it was you, but I wasn't totally sure. And he goes, you have just completely, completely transformed what's going to happen now. You're going to see on the news famous people, film stars, TV presenters, members of parliament, and one particular man that has been had a key to a hospital ward of very disabled people. And I work with special needs, wheelchair work, doing personal care one day a week now. And that he was going in there and assaulting these women in the night and they couldn't tell anybody because they couldn't speak because they had like cerebral palsy and autism. He was a famous guy in our nation. He's died now. He was like a massive fundraiser, really respected. And the whole time he was literally sexually abusing women from all ages. And it went on like that, and more, and it's still going on, 3 years, 4 years down the road. You see, I did it, it was complete utter, duh. But something gripped my heart for these women. And it's just gone on from there, I've got more and more confidence now. Yeah, so take heart. You can do this. It is way easier than you think. Just let Holy Spirit stir your heart for the things that really concern the Father. There's a court in heaven now that I actually have a seat. I know he died when I got a seat there. I was like, Ian, there's this big chair and it has my name on it. And he goes, yep, get the super glue and sit down. He goes, you've got to sit your bum on the seat. He goes, you need some super glue. And I'm like, okay, Ian. I don't know how to do that. He goes, by faith, frame it up. So, yeah, there's a court in heaven that I go and sit there. When I'm called up there, I don't get called up there all the time. And it's to do with some really crazy stuff that's going on in the nations. It's not to do with my own nation. You see, you have governmental authority. I never researched this. I never read any of the books. For some people, that's a good thing. For me, that would have just freaked me out, made me terrified, and I'd need deliverance. So you've got to come under the government of heaven, what I'm trying to say. It stirs your heart. We've changed the weather in the courts of heaven. We've done some crazy things. as a group and on our own, and we're just seeing the fruit of that over and over again. When you've prayed something, look at the news, check the news feed, check on, you know, whatever you've prayed into, check it out if it's something national. And you're fine with your family. I've took so many court cases with my family. We've just seen mass restoration with my family on a scale that would take me all day to tell you what's happened. Financially, physically, spiritually, emotionally. In the last couple of months, we've seen incredible transitions, restitution on every level. My children might not need a mortgage for their house now. We've shifted so much finance. And they're 24 and 27. They might never have a mortgage on a house. And look at me. I am not the most. I couldn't read till I was 12. And I still spell backwards now sometimes. But you know, I know Jesus. I am known in heaven. You are known in heaven. And we're not sharing these stories, me and Stevie, to blow us up, to puff us up. We're doing it to encourage you. It's all about encouraging you. Thank you, Jesus. Humble and I'm proud of it. So funny. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. But you're ever living people. Ever living beings. Immortality is yours. Without spot or wrinkle. I'll have it. We say in Wales, if you don't want it, I'll have it. Okay. Voices in the courts quickly now. The blood, the voice of the Lord Jesus, the blood of Jesus speaks on your behalf, testifies. The throne of God, it allows the Lord legal right to fulfill his passion. The mediator, the new covenant. The mediators are the officers of the legal system sent to resolve conflict. Who is Jesus? He's your conflict resolver. Remember that. It's a good thing to remember. Cloud of witnesses. The spirit of just men made perfect. Oh, I want to be made perfect. I often think about the cloud of witnesses. I think, oh, it'd be really fun, though. I mean, we can move in the spirit in the kingdom around, but imagine being one of the cloud of witnesses there. Whoa, freaky. Now you see me, now you don't. People! That'd be so much fun. One day I was praying and my friend's face appeared on my bedroom wall like a big, massive head. I screamed the blaze down. She scared me stupid, then just laughed her head off and she disappeared into the wall. So I phoned her up and she's like, did you like that? And I was like, no, you freaked me out, mate. She said, I just thought it'd be a bit of fun to check up on you. Nutty, nutty, nutty. Don't get any ideas, Stevie. God, the judge of all. Isn't it interesting that God is revealed not as Father, but Lord, that we said earlier, but judge is the judge. It's because the Holy Spirit desires us to recognize the legal position that God holds. Sobering. Fear the fear of the Lord now. Wow. Because life flows through honor. Honor. Wow. The ecclesia, the church of the firstborn, registered in heaven. You are the ecclesia. You have legal right to operate there. You are part of the process of heaven. You have authorization and you are recognized there. You have a seat there. You have a place to go and petition, but you also have a place to sit and judge or stand and judge. What have you ever thought? What I think things like this. What do you think you look like there? Do you think you look like this? No. Let's not go there. The General Assembly. Worshippers, Revelation 5:14 shows us that worship starts around the throne and moves from spheres to spheres until all of creation is worshipping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Ah! Lightnings, thunders, rainbows. You think it's quiet in heaven? Well, which heaven are you going to? You get that, didn't you, Darren? You got that one. Did you know the General Assembly in the Greek means universal companionship? Universal. No boundaries, no gates. Companionship. Friendship. Love sick with Jesus. No, that's another realm. And speaks of multitudes of worshiping the Lord around the throne. Their function of worship is essential for the operation of the courts. Remember what I said about David? 24/7 worship to govern the nations. Are we getting it? Are we getting this? Angels! Woo! My favorite. Whirling, twirling, crazy, cheeky, holy, monkey, cheeky angels. The voice of the archangels. They are powerful beings. They're not fluffy bunnies, not the ones I've met. 1 Thessalonians 4:16. I love this in the Mirror Translation. He, the Lord, will personally step out in visible heavenly realms into our immediate visible horizon with an inciting, shouting, announcing, triumphant rain, trumpet-like billowing voice of God. Don't think I can say that again. And even the dead will rise from their sleeper. Wake, awake, O sleeper, as Christ takes his position as ruler over the nations. So the angels are an essential part of our lives. Can we speak to angels? Psalm 103. Amigos, amigos. They're our servants, our friends. They should be your best friends like Holy Spirit. Because life would be boring and dull without them. Thank you, Jesus. Michael contended with the devil in Jude 1, 8-9, and a numeral company of angels, ranks of angels came from the operation of the courts in heaven to aid and help him. The bride, Song of Solomon 4:9, my sister, my spouse, you have ravished my heart with one look of your eyes, with one link of your necklace. You are beautiful. You are gorgeous. You are holy. Because it says in Revelation 21:2, this actually speaks the bride, the wife of the Lamb, the ecclesia, the firstborn, the church of Jesus Christ. You are the church, the firstborn, the ecclesia. You are the Lord's pleasure. Wow, nearly done. Thank you, Jesus. Agreeing with our adversary, confessing our sin. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Colossians 2 shows us every bit of paperwork against us in heaven. Jesus nailed to the cross. The word handwriting requirements actually means legal documentation, decree. His sacrifice has dealt with every hidden thing, every bloodline that stands in the way of us between God and man, and the courts and the verdicts of heaven. The spirit of revelation brings these things to light. And as we repent in true submission to the Lord, applying the blood of Jesus, we are set free on a multitude of levels. Jesus' sacrifice, when we repent, we apply the blood of Jesus, breaks every place the devil might try to exploit and have a foothold in our lives and in our case in the courts of heaven. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. James 4:7. As we come in as priests into the courtroom, when we leave, make no mistake, when the verdict has been rendered, we are kings. We step out and we decree what has already been done in the courts of heaven. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. An example, Lazarus, John 11:41-44. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was laying. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. Father, I thank you that you heard me for that 12-year-old girl in India. Father, I thank you that you heard me for my petition for the women in my nation. And I know that you always hear me. He always hears us because of the people who are standing by. He's talking of the courts, that they may believe that you sent me. Now, when he had said these things, he cried out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he who had died came out, bound hand, foot, with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped in cloth. And Jesus said to them, loose him and let him go. Once we have the things legally in place, we can then step into our kinship and make decrees, the courts of heaven back us up, totally back us up. As we utter words of governmental decrees, the heavenly realm is recorded and things come into place for heaven to invade earth. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. We just thank you now, Lord, as we come before you and we begin to present our case in the courts of heaven. Father, we ask you now to stir each and every one of our hearts, that Holy Spirit will come with revelation. We have eyes to see and ears to hear what the Lord wants to bring today into the courts of heaven. Thank you, Jesus. We come soberly, but we come with righteousness and truth. We come with authority. We come with permission. We come by faith. We come with your mercy. We come with trust. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Wow, Jesus. Thank you, God. Your will be done on heaven as it shall be on the earth. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom done, come. Your will be done in heaven as it shall be on the earth. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, 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 hey. Wow. Thank you, Lord. So, Lord, we ask for your clarity. We ask for your understanding. We ask for your revelation today. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. I really felt like the Lord was saying that this place, as I said earlier, it was meant to be that hub, that place where it goes out across the nation to see absolute revival. There is no doubt about it. Absolute healings on multiple scales. Whatever's blocking it, whatever we're not quite aligning with, we're going to take that into the courts today. I really felt there's a level of religion and idolatry, particularly idolatry, but not, I had a chat with Darren about it, but not so much that you're not a generous nation, but sometimes there's things we don't know until we go into the courts. The Lord shows us that we need to repent of. We think we know, but we don't always. So we have to keep our hearts open and our minds and our thoughts. Okay? So what I'm going to do, I'm going to ask Sandy to come. I've written out a few things. And I want two of you to come. And the Lord stirred your heart already while I've been speaking what we're going to repent of. So if two people come and just one at a time say what the Lord's laid on your heart to repent of, to do with particularly this region, particularly this revival center, particularly what you've been praying for. I mean, the heritage here is incredible. And you're really running with so much stuff. You know, the things that you're doing here are incredible. And where, you know, your apple wine awakening, that is epic. I was reading the words yesterday and the words from Jeremy Nelson and all the different people that have come and all the people that have come through here and released prophetic words and released that sound and those frequencies in the nation. But we want to see no poverty on it. We want to see complete release. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Do you want to come and help me, guys, as well, Stevie and Darren and you guys? You see how we work together? It's not just about what I think. We're all hearing God. We've all got a part to play. It's like a jigsaw puzzle. We all need every piece. Union in common union, in community. Thank you, Jesus. Did you? Just keep it short, though, because, you know.
The Lord is showing me sexual perversion and homosexuality to bring that to the court for forgiveness.
So, Father, we just repent where we have had any sexual perversity. Lord, where we have operated, wow, Jesus, just write it down, just put one. So, Father, we repent for that. Father, we repent where we have abused others in thought, word, and deed. Father, we repent of condoning sexual immorality, where we condone homosexuality and multiple gender, multiple marriages. I can see it right now. Where there are three women and two guys and they're all married together with loads of children. Father, we just repent right now in Jesus. We say we are truly sorry where we have let that run riot in our nation. Thank you, Jesus.
And Father, we want to repent as a church for allowing God, like gay marriage and homosexual marriage in the church. Lord, forgive us. Because, Lord God, your word says, if my people will humble themselves and pray, then you'll heal our land. So forgive us, Lord God, for allowing it in our nation, in our land, in our churches, Lord God.
Thank you, Jesus. Wow. Thank you, Father. Father, I come before you now, and I just want to repent, Lord. I really felt like we needed to do something with bloodline altars, of incantations, of voodoo, of witchcraft, of death. So if somebody wants to come and pray.
Yeah, so we just, Father, we thank you, Lord, and we just repent of divination, sorcery, witchcraft, rebellion, these things that have been operational within even the church. And Lord, we just repent of manipulation, control, trying to control people for whatever kind of end. Father, we just repent, Father, and we ask that you would forgive us for partnering with these spirits.
Thank you, Jesus. You see how we're beginning to get words, all of us. So don't be shy. Come and what's on your heart? It's okay. There's actually no right and wrong, because in the courts of heaven, whatever we repent of is going to be dealt with. Thank you, Jesus.
Fear of evil being stronger than fear of the Lord and murder.
So, Lord, we just repent of that. We just repent of not coming under the mantle of the fear of the Lord, but that fear of fear, Lord. We just ask you to remove all fear, lack of confidence, lack of identity. Wow. Lack of being a son. Not believing that we are adopted into the heavenly family. Of isolation, of suffocation. Father, forgive us, Lord. We repent because it says in your word the opposite. Thank you, Jesus. Wow.
Father, we just repent of parental neglect for reasons of greed, Lord God, underlying greed of the next new house or a new car or the new vacation, Lord God, and shirking our responsibility, Lord God, as parents, Lord, to pour our life in this next generation, Lord God, to raise up believers, oh God, and fire-praying warriors, Lord Jesus, and people, Lord, who walk, Lord God, and who are not afraid to be different and to walk with you, to know you, Lord God. We repent, Lord God, of shirking of our responsibilities as parents for idolatry's sake.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Father, we just repent for dishonoring our covenants with First Nations people, for marginalizing them, and for the spilling of innocent blood.
Thank you, Jesus. Wow. Yeah, Lord, we repent. Where we've seen them as second-class citizens, where we stole and raped their land and took their women and children in centuries past. And Lord, where now we think it's our legal right to build housing estates on their reservations, Lord, where we have robbed and stolen and killed people with word, thought, and deed. Lord, it's not just in the natural, it's the thought and the murder in our hearts where we have hated them. Lord, forgive us. Father, I just want to repent of Freemasonry in the nation. That controlling stronghold. We just repent now in Jesus' name where any of our bloodlines, our generations going right back to Adam, Lord, where they have been involved in this cult, in this religion, in this masonry of death. It just brings death, Lord. Forgive us. We repent.
Father, we repent for abortion going for so long, for so many years, for so much innocent blood. It's a river, Lord, and it needs to end. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, we repent of that suffocating spirit, Lord. We repent, Lord. We never want to be like the church of Laodicea where it said you wanted to spew the church out of your mouth, that we are neither hot nor cold, Lord. I just thank you now and I repent for that, Lord, that we are a church that's on fire, full of fire, wild fire. Forgive us where we have not allowed ourselves to come under that fire, the burning heart of your love and fire.
I felt like the Lord was saying back to that spirit of death over this region and suicide and having to do with drug addiction with the youth especially, and it results in an absence of life. And so I just come before you, God, and I just ask, Father, that you would break the spirit of death over Seattle, over Portland, over the West Coast. I ask, Father, that you would bring life, and I breathe life onto the streets of Seattle, onto the streets of our nation, Father, into the homeless. And Father, I pray that you would pour out your spirit upon all flesh, Father, that you would rise up within the church. And I pray, Father, against the spirit of suicide in our young people. And we just declare an end to that in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Father. Yeah, where death has come in through the window, Lord, it says a scripture about, you know, call on your women and your children and your families to pray for the nation. Father, forgive us where we have allowed death on all levels. Thank you, Father.
I just felt like the Lord was saying that we need to repent for a rejection of revival in this region. Whoa. Yeah, Lord, we just repent, Father. God, where we've rejected the supernatural. God, where there's a fear, God, of you deceiving us, Lord, rather than you leading us, God. We just repent for that, Father. Whoa! We repent, God, where we've rejected revivals that have come in. Father, we've rejected your prophets. We've rejected. Whoa! God, we repent, Father. We repent, God. Whoa!
Yes, Lord, we just repent of that antichrist spirit. Wow. That spirit of domination and control, we think it's going to be the way we think. Lord, forgive us. Who are we to say we think we know how to do it? Lord, forgive us right now. We just repent. Jesus.
I repent on behalf of the church for the misogynistic attitude towards women and their leadership in the church, and also for the self-centeredness, how we think it's all about us and not about Him, the truth, the source of everything. And also about the vanity that lies within us, deep inside of us.
Yeah, Lord, forgive our selfish ambition, our pride, our idolatry. Lord, forgive us, because we are made in your image. Thank you, Jesus. Forgive us, Lord, for the lust for power, for the lust for domination, for the lust for self-control. Lord, forgive us. Father, I pray that you'll forgive us for cruelty towards others, for robbing other people's properties and stealing their inheritance. Lord, we repent where we have allowed Satan to take things from us, to rob our children, Lord, the prodigals. Lord, we ask that you'd forgive us now. We repent. Thank you, Jesus.
And Father, we repent of racism and elevating ourselves above others because of the color of our skin, or for judgments that we've placed on others, on other tribes, on other people groups. Father, we repent of mockery and partnering with the spirit of mockery when it comes to other people groups, with others that are different from us. So Father, forgive us of those things.
Father, we love you, Jesus.
Lord, we just ask for forgiveness and repentance all the way back to Adam and Eve, of the scripture that you gave, that Jesus summed it all up. He said to love God with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and all our strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves, God. So I just pray for repentance of the body of Christ, and that we would rise up into the likeness and image of who you said we are, Lord. And we're to love you and to love others, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we repent for prejudice and dividing churches by colors and languages, for ethnocentrism, tribalism, and bringing culture more than you, bringing more than kingdom culture. And as a refugee coming from another, forgive us for bringing idols to this land. Hey, Rebecca, Dana, Sepa, Ruba, Gire, bring idolatry as a culture to this land, bringing contamination. I repent. Hallelujah.
Father, we repent of false gods, worshiping other images. Father, forgive us where we have worshipped anything else but you. Father, we repent of that idolatry practice. We say there's only one true God.
I feel that we need to repent for the child sacrifice, all the sacrifices that are going on concerning Freemasonry, but also with the trafficking in this nation and all around the world. And I ask that Father will forgive us for not stepping in and dealing with this and shoving it under the carpet. It needs to come out. It needs to come out now.
Thank you, Jesus. Last year, I was part of as I mentioned earlier, slightly, the group in Texas, and we paid for the Bill 2 abortion bill. And we did it three times, but on the third time, one of the court judges died on one of the weekends. One of the high court judges, so it had to keep going back to court. But eventually, as you already probably know, we withheld the bill to change the dates for abortion, because they were going to bring it that you could have an abortion right up until full term. So it was a bill to keep it withheld, and it's finally in place. And now we're going through the same bill in the UK. There's a group of radicals. They're a minority, it's always a minority group, that are lobbying for abortion right up till full term. And they're gaining more and more strength in our nation. So we're starting to petition in the courts of heaven, waiting on the Lord for what he wants to bring and what he wants to do. Thank you, Jesus.
I want to repent for the spirit of Leviathan, for the twisting of the truth, and for the fact that we, so many of us, have fallen for it. All of us fall for it.
Yeah, Lord, forgive us.
I want to repent for the sin of believing the whispers of the enemy in our ears all the time from the beginning, telling us that we aren't enough by ourselves and we must not love God. We must do it ourselves and hurt people and strive and kill in order to make ourselves be okay or big enough or strong enough, whether we're a man or a woman. And we've abused each other, but I think most of all, the lies of the enemy we have believed.
Yeah, Lord, forgive us. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. I'm just going to wait a moment.
I repent as an individual and for the church for not having a voice for all the liberal laws that have been passed, that have influenced our nation and have influenced the world. I repent for not having a voice in the company where I work and the people that I know. I repent for giving up my voice.
Jesus, wow. Father, thank you. You are the judge of all. Wow. Thank you that what you say goes in the courts of heaven. And if we humble ourselves and pray in true repentance, we'll see the nations changed.
Repent for wealth, the lust for wealth, the lust for status, and the lust for celebrity, and also most of all, for this, repenting for the spirit of rebellion and division.
Yes, Lord, forgive us for our divisive ways where we have brought division, known or unknown, to the body of Christ. Father, we repent. We come before you in true repentance. Father, we repent where we have brought disunity through gossip, through whispering spirits, through that Jezebelic spirit. We repent, Lord. Where it has undermined the leadership of the church and the government of God, which is the government in heaven. Father, forgive. Forgive us, Lord. Father, I pray now that, Lord, wow, Jesus, we say that it is completely unjust that we have not got 24/7 revival, that we have not got 24/7 healings, that we have not cleared the hospitals and cleared the waiting rooms in the walk-in centres. Father, we say that is super unjust. Father, we say it's unjust that we still have sickness in our body. Father, we say it's unjust that people are still dying of cancer, that are still dying of heart attack, that are still dying of disease. Father, we say that is unjust, and we bring that into the courts today. And we ask for your justice and your judgment, that you would judge sickness, that you would judge that antichrist spirit, that you would judge that rebellious spirit, that you would judge that Jezebelic Leviathan spirit, that you would judge anything that comes up to oppose this church and the churches in Seattle. Lord, forgive us where we have been part of that. So we ask for your justice in the courts today, that you rule on our behalf, that you rule in our favor, that what you say is a legal proclamation, it's a legal document, and as it is in heaven, so it shall be released on the earth. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Wow. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes when we're in the courts, we don't quite feel it's done. I always feel like this realm of rest comes in, like a really weighty presence comes in. I'm not quite feeling that right now. So I'm going to wait a little bit longer because there'll be millions and loads of other stuff that will now begin to trigger in your thinking and in your heart. Here we go. Thank you. Wow.
Father, we repent for doubt and unbelief and thinking that's the norm. Jesus.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. And that's okay, because sometimes you need to come back as a church yourselves. You need to come back as a group and do it yourselves, whether it be personally or together as a group. That's okay. I go back and stick paws on it. Because with my family, it wasn't just one case. It took a while. But I still felt the rest on the bit that we've done today. I can feel that peace coming in right now. Thank you, God. So what we're going to do now, we're just going to go into decreeing. All that we've repented of, we now decree. And we speak forth the things that the Lord has already done in the courts today and he's already judged. Thank you, God.
And we just repent of divorce. So, Father, we repent of divorce and broken marriages. Forgive us, Father. Forgive us. Forgive us. Forgive us. Forgive us. Forgive us for every marriage broken, for every marriage shattered, for every broken home. In our community, in this region, in this state, in this country, forgive us, the church, for not modeling the marriage covenant, for not modeling manhood, for not modeling femininity, for not modeling healthy family, for not modeling what it means to be a father, for not modeling what it means to be a mother. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. Thank you.
Thank you, God. And Lord, I stand in the courts as a woman that's been divorced, that didn't want to be divorced. I never wanted to be divorced. I always wanted to stay married. But that was the will of my ex-husband. But Lord, I forgive him many years ago, but I come on another level of a woman that's been through that. And I repent and stand in the gap for all the women and children and fathers of this nation. I stand for them in the courts today. We all stand for them in the courts today. And we say, Father, forgive us. Lord, we repent of the disunity of the heartbroken children, of the misunderstanding that just completely messed up their heads. We thank you, God. Just repent on their behalf.
Lord, and we repent for lust and for adultery, Lord.
Thank you, God. Just one more.
Yes, I repent for anger. I sense the Lord said anger is counterfeit authority. I've sold out my God-given authority and taken the counterfeit of anger. And so I just repent of that. Yes, in Jesus' name.
Yeah, Lord, forgive us when we go into a rage and we say things that we would never have said when we weren't angered or triggered in our heart. Creating us a pure heart and a contrite spirit. Wow. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. So what we're going to do now, we're going to start decreeing. We're going to shift, because I felt as soon as Darren said about divorce, I knew there was something else we hadn't quite, and that's okay. It takes time. I just feel like that there was like a realm of peace comes in, a realm where it transition is into decreeing. So what we do now, we step out of the courts and we start to decree. So for example, wow, thank you, God. I thank you that you are restoring families. That as you have brought mass restitution and restoring to my family, to my children, that you're now bringing restoration. We release that spirit of restitution. Restoration in this nation and in this church. Father, I thank you for those phone calls, those cards, those letters, those text messages of people that have not spoken together for years, ex-husbands, ex-wives. I can see it right now on people's iPhones, messaging each other. They don't know why. They've been stirred in their hearts to message the person to bring restoration. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Wow. We decree that this is going to be a place of total disease-free. This is going to be a cancer-free zone. I repeat, like John G. Lake and beyond anything he ever walked in, and William Branham and Mariah Woodworth Etta, Lord, that we're going to see cleansing and healing in the land. Father, we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord. We just decree and declare right now there will be no racism, no more racism in this region, in this nation. Father, we break that rejection. We break that suffocating spirit. And we just decree a nation. Wow. Jesus. Wow. Multicultural. Multi-language. Multilinguistic. Full of love. Full of acceptance for one another. Because you make space for everyone. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we just declare that we'll have no other gods before us. Father, we just thank you that we no longer need the middleman. God, that we'll never again reject your invitation to come up here. We'll never again reject your invitation for intimacy, for union. We'll never again reject your word, God. We just declare that we are a people, we are a people fully engaged with you, with your heart. Fully engaged with you and your heart. Fully engaged with you and your world, fully believing, Lord, your word, what you've spoken, what you've declared, and what you've decreed in the past. We declare, Father God, that we are people with eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts that are tender and fully yielded to what it is you're saying, what it is you're doing. And therefore, we are a people that the world is drawn to because they see you in us. We declare that, Father, today in Jesus' name.
Father, we decree and declare that we are magnets, that this place is a place where thousands will gather. The 24 worship, the 24/7, the 24 governmental realms. We thank you, Lord, that you're about to change the topography of the nation. We thank you that the catalyst will begin here and go forth into the nations. We thank you for the favor on Seattle. We thank you for the favor on the industries. We thank you for the favor on new technologies. We thank you for the favor, Jesus. Like the ships, that the men will come to seek wisdom in this nation. We thank you when Queen of Sheba came to visit Solomon because he was so full of wisdom. He was so full of revelation and glory. We thank you that people will come to this place, Seattle Revival Center, to seek wisdom, to seek revelation and understanding because they know that God is in the house. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
And we just declare and decree a love for family in Seattle and in this region, a love and a celebration of children. And we just declare and decree that a new baby boom here in Seattle, that families would start to have more children than pets. And we just declare and decree a new level of biblical sexuality over Seattle and over this region. We declare and decree, God, yeah, a revelation of true and perfect gender identity. And that sexual confusion would be displaced with a revelation of true and perfect gender identity. And we just declare shame-free sexuality in the church. For every marriage, shame-free sexuality. And that perversion and secrecy would be displaced with the kind of sexuality that is worship and pleasing to the Lord. So we just declare this a shame-free zone, a shame-free region. And Father, where there's been that curse of Freemasonry, we declare the end of secrecy and isolation, that those hidden things are being exposed, and we just declare cultures of transparency and vulnerability, where transparency and vulnerability are celebrated. We just declare a celebration of true and perfect identity in Christ Jesus.
And Father, we just decree and declare the end to male and female and children being trafficked in this region and in this area. We decree this will be a free zone. There will be no more prostitution. There will be no more people trafficked in secret, shipped in from other nations, in ship containers and hidden, in slavery. We say that there will be no more slavery on any level of any gender in Seattle and in this nation. We come into agreement under the government of heaven. We thank you, God. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Wow. Woo-hoo! Jesus, come on. Come on, Jesus. Wow.
Lord, I thank you and I declare that men know they are men in the sight of God. They were created fantastic. They were created amazing. They were created with all this power and glory we've been talking about. And I declare that women also know that they are equal, they are amazing, that they are created to be amazing people, and they complement each other in these glory ways, and that there is no need for degradation. There is no need to go seeking for it. They already have it because we are your kids, and you created us, and we are your kids, and may we never forget it. May the men stand up and be proud to be a man. And if anybody's had their balls cut off, replace them now. I declare them replaced, replaced, replaced. And women who have been oppressed, they rise up and take their place. Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we thank you that this will be a place that's known for culture. Wow, for dancing and singing and musicians and orchestras and you know what I mean. A place of creativity, a place of artisans, a place of minstrels, a place of sounds and lyrics and songs and groups, Lord. We thank you it will be a place of famous for its culture. We pray, Father, we decree and declare that this place will be known for families, that it will be known for fun and love and joy and singing and dancing. Woo! Because this train is bound for glory.
declare for myself. He wants me to declare that I'll grow. I can read your mind. I can read your mind. And Lord, I just want to decree that this region is going to see such an outpouring of glory, that this region is going to go from Pentecost to tabernacles. I decree that we're going from visitation to habitation. I decree that we're going from just revival into the governmental realms of heaven. I decree that this region is going to have such a move of the Spirit that the whole of the US of A is going to look to this region. I decree that the governmental realms of heaven is now established here. I decree that there's been a tent peg driven into the ground. I decree that there's a pillar here. And that from this place, there is a ladder. The secret of the stairs. A place where people come and engage in Mount Zion. A place where people come and engage in the councils in heaven. A place where people come and mature into the mature sons. I decree that from this day, yesterday, today, and tonight, that there's been a change forever. And that God has found a place of government here. I decree that the true apostolic is here. In the name of Yod, He, Vav, He.
Yeah, Father, we also just declare and decree a culture of honor amongst the generations. That the builder generation would be honored, and that the boomer generation would be honored, and that the Xers would be honored, and that the millennials would be honored, and that the generation Echo would be honored. And Father, Lord, we ask for a harvest of the generations. And a celebration of the generations, and that there wouldn't be a tolerance for any disrespect or words of dishonor towards a particular generation. Father, we declare a celebration of the generations, that the generations would run together, and that zeal, passion, and wisdom would collaborate in this hour. Lord, that zeal and wisdom would collaborate. Lord, that the generations would collaborate. And so, Father, we declare a harvest of even Xers, Father, and a harvest of millennials, Father, that unreached generations would be reached. In this hour, in the present, we declare in the present a harvest of the unreached generations. Father, we declare blessing. We bless the generations. We bless the generations. And Father, we ask for a multi-generational harvest. We just declare multi-generational harvest. Yeah, multi-ethnic harvest, that there'd be a celebration of the generations and a celebration of cultures. Yeah. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah, let's just give the Lord a shout. So we'll be. it's time for tea. So we will see you tonight, 7 p.m. With Powerhouse Jane is going to be bringing it tonight. So this has been great. God bless you guys online. God bless everyone here. Have a good cup of tea. And take your stuff with you off your seats.